بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الواحد المنعم والصلاة والسلام على محمد سيد الأنام وعلى آله الكرام وصحبه العظام وسلم تسليما كثيرا ما دام يجري هذا النظام وبعد قال تبارك وتعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا استجيبوا لله وللرسول إذا دعاكم لما يحييكم. Respected brothers, elders, mothers, sisters and youngsters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty, the only entity entitled to worship, and we send the choicest blessings upon the final messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace and blessings upon him. There is a common saying, change happens by listening. So when we listen, when we hear, we understand. And when we understand, when we comprehend, the next step is we apply and we practice. And the final verses of Surah Al-Baqarah that many of us constantly recite or have memorized, they remind us about this lesson that listening should not entail only listening. It should rather also entail understanding, comprehending, and applying and practicing. And the entire incident has been recorded on the authority of Abu Hurairah radiallahu an. He makes a mention that when these few verses of the Quran were revealed to the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, our anticipation and our duty was that we would go learn the verses and we would immediately apply. So the verses were revealed, wa in tubdu ma fi anfusikum aw tukhfuhu yuhasibkum bihi Allah. That whatever you make apparent, you will be taken to task in regards to that. Wa in tukhfu, and whatever you hide, whatever you conceal, the thoughts, the perceptions, the intentions, you will also be taken to task in regards to that. So ishtadda dhalika ala sahabati rasuli sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu makes a mention that when the companions heard this part of the verse, that whatever we conceal, whatever we hide, we have not expressed it. A person gets a flash to commit a sin. A person gets a thought of something that is inappropriate. And Allah is mentioning that we will be taken to task, we will be punished for that. This is something very severe upon us. They gathered together, Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu says, and we approach the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. With utmost respect, we address the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. And we said to him, قَدْ أَنزَلَ عَلَيْكَ هَذِهِ الْآيَةِ وَلَا نُطِيقُهَا. The reality of the matter is this verse has been revealed and we feel that we are unable to live up to the expectations of this verse. And to justify their understanding, they explained that كُلِّفْنَا, we have been duty-bound to perform certain actions. As-salatu was-siyamu was-sadaqah. You obliged us to perform prayers. We are diligently performing the prayers. You obliged us to fast. We are fasting when it is required. You instructed us to discharge charity. We adhered and we discharged our charity. But this matter that evil thoughts come into our mind and we will be taken to task for that, this is something beyond our capacity. And we don't understand how we will be able to practice, adhere, and follow this specific verse of the Quran that has been revealed to you today. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, he never faced this situation before where he instructed something and the companions would have objected. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said to the companions, أَتُرِيدُونَ أَن تَقُولُوا كَمَا قَالَ أَهْلُ الْكِتَابَيْنِ, that are you going to say to me what the previous nations said to their prophets, سَمِعْنَا وَعَصَيْنَا, that we have heard, but we cannot practice, we disobey, we do not discharge. Are you telling me that you're not ready to adhere to this verse? This is a verse that has been revealed. I presented this verse to you. You're finding it difficult, but this does not mean that we deny, we reject, and we disobey. And then the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, instructed them, do your best. Do your best to try and adhere to this verse and leave the rest up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From that point onwards, the companions felt it very difficult to control the thoughts of their minds, because they had this understanding that they will be taken to task for this. And they felt very disturbed. After a period of time, the verses were revealed where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declared, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not punish an individual for something that is beyond their capacity. And in the tafsir of this verse, as a side note, all the ulama, the jurists, the mufassirun, the commentators, they have pointed out that when the flash or a thought of a sin comes to mind, a person is not taken to task. But if an individual follows up the thought and plans how to act and plans how to enforce or bring into existence this sin or this thought that has come to mind, that is the sin that is taken to task and a person is punished for. So the point I'm making here is that why was this objection raised by the Sahaba? The reason is that they had the attitude of sami'na wa ata'na, that when we hear, we follow, we obey. When we hear, we put it into practice. But this just seemed out of place, that it's very difficult to practice this particular verse. But when they were given the reminder, they adhered, they followed through. So in today's time, in modern time, we have a lot of material. We have many seminars after seminar, events after events, conferences after conference, sermons, deliberations, reading material online, etc., even in book format. All of this is present. Yet, we need to ask ourselves the question, is this simply reading for the sake of reading, listening for the sake of listening, or is it bringing a positive change into my life that by listening I'm understanding, and by understanding I'm applying, and by applying I'm obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the reality of the matter is what Imam al-Shafi'i said, rahimahullah. He was asked about this concept and this topic, and he said, the person who reads, the person who listens, yet does not practice, it's like the laundry man who takes the clothes of others and washes their clothes, but then he himself, his clothing is dirty and filthy and impure. So people benefit from listening, from reading, from accessing the knowledge and the good things. But if we don't apply it, if we don't understand it and then apply it, that is where it becomes a stain upon ourselves. So how can we become amongst those who were very close to the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him? Their attitude was sami'na wa ata'na, that we hear and we follow, we obey. And we see the recommendations by the ulama and the scholars. They say, firstly, when we hear, we should be present. And a scholar pointed out that there's a difference between listening and hearing. There's a difference between listening and hearing. Listening is simply we are listening to sounds. It may not be something that we are comprehending or understanding. And when we hear, we are taking it in. We are absorbing it. We are implementing it. We are getting a proper understanding of it. Imam Hakim, rahimahullah, was asked a question. And that question was, مَا بَالُ الْعُلَمَاءِ فِي زَمَانِنَا لَا يَتَّعِذُ النَّاسُ بِمَوَاضِعِهِمْ كَمَا كَانَ يَتَّعِذُ أَهْلُ السَّلَفِ. That why is it that we see today that when teachers and preachers place their pitch and they present the discussions and they explain the concepts, we see that the masses don't really bring in positive change to the degree that it was in the past. And he responded by saying, there was a huge difference between the people of the past and the people of today. And he said, the reality is, the preachers and the teachers of the previous times, they were awake and the masses were in a slumber or in sleep. And these teachers and preachers, they awoken the people through their inspiration and motivation. But the reality of the matter is, in today's time, the teachers and the preachers are asleep and the general masses are almost dead. So how can one who is asleep bring someone alive who is dormant and dead? So the reality of the matter is we all need a reality check. The teachers and the preachers, and also the listeners. So when we do a reality check, then we'll get to understand that what's not motivating me, what's the distraction, what's causing the obstacle for me to listen, understand, and apply. As the tafsir of the verse, Sami'na wa ata'na, the commentators write, Sami'na biqulubina wa alsinatina, that we should listen with our hearts. We should listen with our tongues by repeating what we heard and applying with our limbs, with our bodies. So the narration of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, also indicates many narrations about when a person listens with the intention or engages with the intention that is sincere, Allah facilitates success for them. For example, when the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, discusses the matter of taking a loan, the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, gives reference to the intention, and he says a person who takes a loan, and at the point and the transaction of taking a loan, this person's intention is so sincere that as soon as I am able, I will fulfill and return these funds that I have taken. The Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said, divinely this individual will be assisted and facilitated to set off the loan, pay back the loan. But when a person takes the loan and the intention is not sincere to return the loan, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make it difficult for this individual. This is the power of intention. So the ulama tell us that when we hear and when we listen with the intention of understanding and applying, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself will facilitate that success. So introspection. One is that we hear with the intention of listening, and the other is that we need to do a reality check. We need to do an introspection. Umar radiallahu anhu's statement is very famous. He said, "Hasibu anfusakum qabla an tuhasabu," that analyze yourselves. Count your deeds before they are actually counted. Wazinuha qabla an tuzanu, and weigh your deeds, analyze your deeds, evaluate your deeds before they are actually weighed on the Day of Judgment. And then he said, it's better that we analyze and we understand in this world and we make the amends rather than on the Day of Judgment when they are actually weighed and analyzed and placed before us where there will be no opportunity to make the change. So indeed, we need to do a reality check. A person came to the great scholar Ibn Kathir, rahimahullah, and asked that I don't feel the motivation to practice. I've read your tafsir, I've read the books, I don't feel the motivation to practice. So he said, perhaps you can remember the verse of the Quran, بَلْ يُرِيدُ الْإِنسَانُ لِيَفْجُرَ أَمَامَهُ, that a person, Allah is speaking about the person who denies the Day of Judgment. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this verse says that this person perhaps denies the Day of Judgment because they're too accustomed and they're in a habit of engaging in sin. They don't want to abandon the sin, hence they continue to deny the Day of Judgment. But the reality is the Day of Judgment is truth, it's a reality. So Ibn Kathir quoted this verse and said, perhaps you have some habits in your life. Perhaps you're accustomed to some sin or some negative, and it's difficult for you to get out of that and change your ways. So engage in doing a reality check. Look at yourself. What are the negative habits? What are the distractions? What are some of the things that are taking you away from being motivated to do what is right? And then after analyzing yourself and doing this reality check, remind yourself that you are to engage in doing what is right. So indeed, when we do the introspection, when we make the muhasabah, we will definitely find ourselves motivated to do the right thing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the prophets. Many prophets came and they addressed their nations after they were destroyed. And one of the common themes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about when it comes to the messages of the prophets is that they regretted and remorsed for their community. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after discussing in Surah Al-A'raf, a number of messengers, a number of prophets, one after the other, and the outcome, the response the communities gave, and the struggles the prophets and those who adhered to the message of the prophets, the struggles that they went through to propagate the message. Now when these communities were destroyed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the prophet looked at the nation that was destroyed and said, فَكَيْفَ أَسَىٰ عَلَىٰ قَوْمٍ كَافِرِينَ, that how can I remorse and regret over your own habits of denial and rejection? The reminders came, the messages came, the revelation came, the prophets came, but you continued to reject and deny and refuse until the point came where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought about the punishment. So we need to analyze, we need to check ourselves, and before it's too late, we need to make the positive change. Badr, in the occasion of Badr, the campaign of Badr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about this campaign in the Quran. The Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, also went through great struggles and sacrifice. Now at the occasion of Badr, this was the opportunity when the migration had just occurred, and this was a challenge that was presented to the companions, and there was an agreement the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, had made with the Ansar. And the Ansar, the residents of Medina, they had committed that they will only defend the vicinity of Medina. If they're outside, if the campaign or the difficult circumstance is on a suburb or outside the boundaries of Medina, then they don't have that commitment and that agreement. So when the disbelievers, they gathered in Badr, and the challenge was to confront them, the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, was seeking opinions and suggestions from the companions. And it seemed, Sa'd ibn Mu'adh radiallahu anhu, he narrates this, he said, it seemed that the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, was trying to understand whether we are committed to go even outside Medina to defend Islam and Muslims and the lands and the women and children of Medina. So Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, when he just felt this indication, he just had this perception, he said, O Prophet of Allah, are you referring to the fact that we are not committed to go outside Medina and support your cause and support the message? If that is the case, let me make it very clear. I am a representative of all the Ansar. I'm the leader of the Ansar. They have appointed me as the leader, and I speak on behalf of every single one of them. And he said, Sil habla man shi'ta. He said, you tie us to any task or any challenge, and I'm telling you, we are there. You commit to us and you tell us that this is the direction we need to go, we will proceed in that direction. And he also said, Wallahi ma akhadhta min amwalina kana ahabbu ilayna mimma tarakt. The wealth and the resources that you take from us, that is more beloved to us than the wealth that you do not take from us. So we are committed to your cause. We are committed to supporting you. And this is our attitude of sami'na wa ata'na. This is our attitude of listening, understanding, and adhering and doing what is right. So indeed, when we analyze and we introspect and we understand what the instruction and the injunction is, we have to take the next step of applying it and bringing it into our lives. Words should not remain words. They should come into action. They should come into application. And this is the reality of these words, sami'na wa ata'na. As a scholar said, the success of our entire ummah, the success of our entire community lies in these two words, sami'na wa ata'na. One is the challenge that is external, and one is the challenge from within. And the scholar says the challenge that is from within is far more detrimental than the challenge that is external. And he says today, the challenge that we have is many times within, and the solution is in these two words, sami'na wa ata'na, that we have to embrace Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We know what his teachings are. We know what the truth is. We educate ourselves. We read material. We attend lectures, seminars, conferences, events. But how much of that is really impacting ourselves in a positive way. So by introspecting, by committing ourselves and applying and making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we will see ourselves on the right path. Ka'b ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu, he made this commitment. He made a commitment that I want to follow and adhere. Whatever I hear from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I want to hear, I want to listen, I want to understand, and I want to follow through and make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He facilitates this for me. So he mentions, at one occasion, I entered the masjid and I met one of the individuals who was owing money to me. And we engaged in a negotiation and the voices started to raise. The Prophet ﷺ's home was not too far and he heard the discussion and the negotiation. He overheard it. So he opened the curtain and he saw Ka'b. And he said, "Oh Ka'b, come here if you don't mind." He came and the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said to him, "Look, lower the amount and he'll give you what you're asking for." And he didn't want to. In his mind, he's saying he didn't want to lower the amount. It's his right. So he asked the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, "Is this an instruction from you, or are you just suggesting this?" So he said, "No, it's an instruction from me." So he said, "Willingly, I dropped that amount." And the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said, "Now go and take your money." So he went to the individual and he said, "Look, I forgive you this certain amount of the loan and give me whatever remains." And he gave it to him at that spot. Ka'b radiallahu anhu says in the report those funds that the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, had indicated for me, based on that amount that I received, it gave me so much barakah and blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I had never perceived or even imagined. And he says, "I credit this to the commitment I had made. The commitment that I had made that whatever I hear from the Prophet ﷺ, I will understand it. And after understanding it, I will apply it." So we make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst those who, when we listen attentively. And we Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst those that we don't only listen, we also introspect and we apply into our lives. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst those who bring positive change into our lives that make us successful both in this world as well as the everlasting life of the hereafter. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.